What are you saying, King? What are you saying? Injera season.
Bro, see the seat, bro. All four seasons a year, my brother. I'm here all the time. I sit down like I'm a two-man meal by myself.
Yeah, 100%, man.
It's fresh, man. Like, it's beautiful. Two-man a vegan. Mm. And I keep my strength up. You get me? She's got me, bro.
So what are you saying? Vegetable injera, yeah?
The injera.
The whole platter.
The whole thing, fam. All of the different...
The lentils. Carrot thing, the spirits, the lentils thing.
Yeah, she puts a little pepper in there.
Yeah,
nice, man.
Yeah, we're nice.
I love it, bro. It's my favourite place.
Mm. Addis Alem, you know what I'm saying?
But yeah, obviously there's other businesses here as well. It's nice.
Yeah.
But this is my favourite spot. My tribe. So there's a yard shop over there, but two man a vegan. My support sister, you get it.
Nah, I hear it. Injera's good anyway, guys. It's heavy, but it's light, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's like it fills you up.
It's part of the meal.
Mm.
So you have to realise it's just like a bread that you will use.
The sourdough thing.
Yeah, kind you understand. Of, yeah. You use it to kind of like grab and then eat what you want to eat in it. So they've got all different colour lentils, they've got different vegetables. Obviously different places serve it with meat as well, isn't it?
Yeah.
But this woman, how she prefers it, what she specialises in, is because they've got a specific festival in Ethiopian Orthodox churches.
Mm-hmm.
It's Tom. I don't know how to pronounce it properly, but it's something like that, Tom. And they have it's basically like lent. So for about 10 weeks, I think, they go without eating meat.
And unleavened bread, in it? It's the bread without yeast and all of that.
All of that. Yeah. Basically, it's a fasting season and they go without eating any animal products. They basically go vegan, innit? Mm. So for that period, this is what they specialise in and they lean into. So I guess she's a specialist in that. So she provides it all year round for people like myself and other people that just want to try it. Mm. Or they want to have a meat-free day or just a meat-free meal. Because here, Mag's Head Holloway, it's beautiful.
Mag's Head Holloway. So let me ask you a question, because I had some family members come to London recently and I took them to Buna, which is on Holloway Road, close to the station, Highbury and Islington. Same thing, injera. My mum used to take us there, innit, when we were kids. And then when I went to Coventry, we never had injera for years. And then one day I went to a wedding, an Eritrean wedding in Coventry, and I smelt the injera. I was like, rah. I remember that. It unlocked a memory, innit. But like, I'm used to it. Even though I was born and raised in the UK and technically I shouldn't have an attachment to it, because of what my mum was into, that's how I was exposed to it as a child, which is why now I'm, as an adult, I'm open to it, you know. So like the question I suppose I'm trying to ask is, like, have you had any experience introducing people to injera, like, that haven't tried it before? And how,
you know, I was the person that was being introduced to it, you see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So the whole concept, like, bro, I'm born, like, especially like when my pops is half English, I'm used to knife and fork, egg bacon and sausage. You know what I mean? My grandma was a proper cockney, so like there's that culture I was embedded in, I grew from.
Yeah.
So to even step away from that and start eating vegan food. But even before that, coming to a point where you're sitting down eating with your hands.
Yeah.
Like that was a little bit alien to man, but I'm open to it. It looks so lovely. I just want to get me. People cooking for man and showing me. And then on top of that, the whole idea. Look at this setup. Look at this beautiful setup.
Yeah. So see, you take that off.
You lift that off, and you've got a plate, and you've got the injera spreader, and you've got all of this. You're gonna see it in a minute.
Yeah.
The concept is that we all sit down and we eat together.
We share, yeah.
And this is a. From what I understand, it's a very Asians do it too. Mm-hmm. It's a very African concept of us actually being able to trust and love each other, sit down and eat together, and say, "Brother, you eat this, we eat with our."
It's very much a village experience,
which is different here. It's like we nicking my chips.
Yeah.
Which
true.
Is a total different experience.
True.
So you can only really sit down and eat with people that you love, that you trust, and that you want to share with. And
that's
really
what
creates a beautiful bond.
That's what my mother used to say, that she used to admire about her trips to Ethiopia, is just watching people sit down and share food. Now, I like, obviously, when I went to France just now, and like I got into the grounds of the Dub Camp Festival, not one African or Jamaican food stall there.
Yeah.
And obviously, like, as you saw, like, I showed you, like, I met the Senegalese gang, the Ethiopian sister and the Senegalese gang. And like, even though he was selling food and he was on paper plates and it was chicken and rice and stuff like that, but I felt that same kind of, we were all sat down together on the ground, sharing food and talking.
See, man from Senegal, I went to Gambia and they eat, I'm sure they do in Senegal because it's the same people. They eat something called benechin. And bene means one. So they do the same thing. They sit down, it's a rice dish, and everyone washes their hands and they tuck in and eat with their hands together. See what I'm saying? That's on the west. Ethiopia is on the east. So we've got this concept permeating through the whole of the continent.
Yeah, 100%.
Something that I think is quite deep and important part of our culture.
I think it would be cool as part of, it would make sense as part of also like the ancient nomadic kind of thing where, you know, you're traveling around, you're getting the food, you're hunting the food, you're bringing it back to your encampment. And, you know, in most cultures, they have like, you know, you see them, they hold the meat over the campfire and everybody can pull a piece. You know what I mean? The men go and, you know, hunt the food and the woman prepare the food. And
well, I say it's something that we shouldn't lose. It's an important part of culture to be able to trust and love each other so we can eat together.
Yeah, 100%. And I see that continue. Like, I mean, even with my grandma's generation, you know, even I try to keep that alive. Like, I like to cook and when and where is possible to cook a big meal and invite people over. I don't think you came to my last birthday thing, but that's what I did. And even before that, like for my birthday before that, like even if nobody organized it for myself, if I've got enough friends around me at that time, like my friends in Coventry that grew up with me, they would attest to this. Like we will link up and we will throw down like our grandparents used to do when they came to this country and we all lived in the same house. And you know, everybody contributes to a pot of curry goat or whatever. But yeah, I think it's like, what I'm trying to point out is how that same tradition there of the sharing of hands, it still exists. It might be dying out a little bit.
Well, look, it's changed. It's changed its perspective and it's changed its direction. As time moves on, so do some of the cultural practices. We have to decide how we're going to continue these cultural practices.
You need to keep it alive.
When my grandma came to this country, not everybody had a house, not everybody had food. So people would all be living together and saving up so they can get their own property. So you would have, Mr. This one, I'm renting that room, Mr. That one, renting this room. And then we'd all be able to branch out and buy our own things and we'd all be saving. And it'd be one pot that's cooking. Pot would
feed everybody
on the street.
You understand
what I'm saying? 100%. That's something that my grandma was doing in this country.
That's our culture. Even in grandma's church, I grew up with grandma's, like, you know, the church kind of culture in the Midlands. All right, you might, maybe now, but not so much when I was growing up, you're not finding so much of the Pan-Africanism, but you're finding the community in the church.
That means
birthday parties, sister this is cooking that, sister this is cooking this, you know, funerals, wakes, everybody comes together.
We don't have to always say Pan-African. Before we recognise just how African we are.
Already.
Sometimes you would even see it in the church, in our practices. Mm. The reason that we lean towards certain denominations over other denominations is because it aligns with our historical expression.
Yeah, 100%.
Of our spirituality. You see what I'm saying?
Even if you see like certain Yoruba or Ifa or even voodooing celebrations when they do the where they call on the spirits of like Shango or whatever and they behave in a certain way. Yeah. And you see that in the church where like the old ladies in my grandma's church, they go in the spirit and they be jumping around and speaking in tongues and
see people when they get a little drink and they tip in the bar and they say that's for the dead. That's a libation.
Yeah, 100%.
It's a libation and you call the spirits and those that are not with us in the flesh to be with us in line with the spiritual world.
All right,
we have spiritual practices and African practices that we don't recognize that we do.
Yeah.
We just are. A lot of people say that to me as well. I don't talk strong patois.
Yeah.
But some of the elders say to me, you're such a Jamaican.
Yeah.
I don't know.
It's just in
me, but I'm raised under people, which means I express myself in a certain way where it comes out. You know what I'm saying?
I'll run this by you, So, like, based on what you just said there about certain traditions existing. I mean, like, obviously we know that, say, for instance, let's take Brazil.
Mm-hmm.
Africans were taken to Brazil and they hidden the Yoruba and the Ifa or whatever underneath the Catholic You know, they come up with condomble or whatever, and
they hit their combat style underneath the capoeira.
And all of that capoeira as well, yeah, which is something that I've tried. But like, I have this theory that part of the reason why this system thrives is not just because of slavery, but also because of the indoctrination of us into certain systems. I'm not just talking about the work system or the financial system. I'm talking about the religious systems. So basically, the religious systems basically so think of a river. You can cut tributaries off of a river. So when we were colonized by different religions and different people, we started to pray to their gods and pray to their system, which I believe that is kind of the reason why some of these things still work. So say, if we want to be liberated from the system that we're under, like capitalism and whatever, like in practice, we want to do that. We might be able to do that. But also, there's a powerful praying auntie out there somewhere in Birmingham or in London or in Peckham somewhere who's got the best line to God directly with her prayers. That's praying that you get a job. And in turn, that prayer is going into the system of, because in order for you to get a job, that job needs to exist. So like, I know it's a bit out there, but I always have that in the back of my mind.
Well, I do think intention is a really strong part of everything.
Yeah, true.
I think even for a man that deals in voodoo, they have intentions.
Yeah, the intentions is part of the intention.
And I tell you, the people that believe in voodoo, or even it's usually the Christian people.
All the
religious, the Abrahamic faith.
Yeah.
Believe in the non-Abrahamic faith more than the people that are not of Abrahamic faith.
Yeah, true.
Just think of that. They talk about jinns, they talk about devils, they talk about this. They really believe
in the occult.
And in the occult.
Yeah.
They're quite fascinating.
You know what I'm saying?
But the baseline of all of that is just the intention of being able to put your intentions out and have it come back. Now, that also, I believe in that. But also the Bible says, as a man thinketh in his heart,
so is he.
So when we're talking about that, even the Bible now is agreeing that intention is something that is very powerful.
And it's like a deeper version of law of attraction.
Yes. Exactly. It's law of attraction is, for me, sometimes about putting yourself in the right place in order for good things to happen. But sometimes willing for good things to happen is you do more than put yourself in the right place. You start noticing
synchronicities.
But you see, this is about a spiritual thing. Because the, ready for me?
Yeah.
Plato had a real separation of the thing that he's looking at, the object, and the person who's actually doing the looking.
Yeah, the observer.
The observer. Yeah. The object and the observer, there's a real disconnect. And only then can the observer truly understand in his world. But the African way of looking at things, even based on Homer, who studied so much in Africa, we're talking about a relationship. Now, that's what we're really talking about. When you see a relationship between the object and the observer, then there starts to become a meaning. Why are we looking at it like this? Why do we understand it like that? And that's when all of these other things that other people say, that don't mean nothing, mate. What are you on about? But to the person that's connected, and they're looking at the meaning and seeing that all of these bridges are actually being built, you know? And
we can even bring it into, like, animism. So, all right, let's take, for instance, this table. To somebody, this is an inanimate object and whatever. In some cultures, this table serves a purpose, therefore it has something about it. So it's like, you might simply look at it like, oh yeah, this is a table. You lift off that thing. Injera, rah, rah, rah. So this table is still important. It still has a meaning unto itself because of what the observer observe it to be. This is where a man eats.
Exactly.
This is where a man has his moments with his family.
And also, think about the person who put this together.
Yes.
I pretty much doubt. I mean, this is beautiful.
Yeah.
Underneath, underneath this tray, I very much doubt that the person that deals with this table, that dealt with it and put it together, dealt with it with that kind of spiritual
perspective. Nah, this is off the factory floor, mate. This exactly. is, yeah,
you understand?
I mean? Yeah.
Whereas, if you look at like them golden stools from Ghana, you see that people really put energy on spiritual connections.
Even just drums, like the carvings and drums and djembes.
So they built these things to have these interconnecting understandings to connect with the ancestors and those who are not yet born.
And we can go full circle now and we can bring it back to the intention behind the cooking of the food and the sharing of the food. The true soul food, isn't it?
Yeah, man. Exactly. I feel like this one really cooks with love.
Mm.
So
we
got a great thing
going on. Yeah, my G. Man like Jay. Yo, tell them who you is.
Come on, man.
JJ.
Jay the Jegna, man. One and only, fam.
Yes, sir.
I'm in the shadows, but I'm here.
All right. I'm going to let you know what the Injera looks like in a minute, but yes, I have. Good reasoning, as usual.
Man, every time, fam. Mm. Just the bread.
Yeah, yeah, that's the bread.
It's all different things, isn't it? I can't. Well, I'm not gonna pretend that I remember the names.
No. But you know, what I'm saying this one, that's lentils. That's lentils. That's next lentils.
I think that's
cabbage, isn't it? That's cabbage and something.
Yeah.
String beans.
Yeah, man.
We even got beetroot, potato, and that. Demonstrate for them, bro.
Oh yeah, with pleasure.
Give thanks for injuries.
Certain times I'm so happy for this food, man.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying, man.
I'm not gonna lie, still.
We give thanks, man.
Yeah, man, definitely. So yeah, they stay in their culture. They say you eat with your eyes.
Yeah.
Have that
wrap that over there. You get me. The quickest taco ever made, bro. I'm not the joke.
And that's how man 16 stone. Living off this.
Yeah, I'd be getting involved, but I'm filming. But I'm going to put this down now, Carl. I'm hungry, man.
Thank you.
See the extras. Thank you. Yeah, man. All right.
My time.
My favourite one, yeah, is the spinach thing. You better watch me around the spinach thing. There'll be no spinach. Oh, yeah, and carrots. Cabbage, man.
Yeah, man, but it's plenty of injera, man, so take time, man.
Yeah. Johnny, did Johnny style this place, or did he just do the design on the front? Did Johnny style the shop, or did he just do the design on the front?
He did the style.
He did the whole style, yeah? So it was his idea.
He wasn't like this one, he's open.
Okay.
Everything is still out there.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Okay, yeah. Look, in your heart, you know he's who? Hitler. Right about what? Be more precise.
So, yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Somebody's about and that. Spreading a very clear message. Oh, my
dear. They're mincing their words.
Yeah, well, they are mincing their words.
Slightly.
Because it's like in your heart, but right about what? Like mustaches? Yeah. Is he right about mustaches? I don't know, mate. I'm curious now. But yeah, this is happening locally still.